Thank you, Eric. Hello, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about our work on operational semantics of serverless computing. So web applications these days have become really complex, and even simple web applications are used to having three components: a front end, a back end, and a data store. And these web applications are usually designed in a distributed setting in which there are a number of back end servers, a number of database servers, a front end, and a load balancer. With this distributed settings, the web programmers have to deal with some difficulties. For example, they have to write code to do load balancing and resource allocation. Once the number of requests increases, the load has to be balanced equally among all these servers. And when you have paid for these resources, you have to pay for them, even if the number of requests decreases in future. Not only that, they have to also manage failures, write code for failures. What if some of the servers might fail in some time? So building web applications is hard, and there are some difficulties like load balancing, resource allocation, failure detection and recovery. So the question is, how can we provide web programmers with simpler abstractions? And one possible solution is serverless computing, which was made popular first by Amazon's AWS Lambda, and now there are a number of serverless computing platforms available. In serverless computing, a web application programmer can write code in supported languages, and ignoring failures, ignoring load balancing, ignoring resource allocation, the code will be deployed on the serverless platform, and the serverless platform will handle this load balancing, failures, resource allocation, and hence will provide scalability. So the programmer here can actually solely focus on the application code instead of worrying about the other things. However, there are some subtle issues with serverless, and these issues have been described on some blog posts. And in summary, these issues are related to serverless functions being stateless. There is some variation in latency and the serverless requests. There is a lack of tools and libraries to write good good development and debuggability of the serverless functions, and how to compose several serverless functions in efficient ways. So let's look into some of these issues in more detail. And for that, let's imagine a simple model of a serverless function, which takes some requests and gives back some responses. So imagine there is a bank which wants to use the serverless platform. And they deploy this function on the serverless platform. What this function does is it stores the accounts in a global variable. This is a map of account name to the amount that account has. And if that function receives a request of deposit, then it will deposit that amount. And if it receives a request of transfer, then it will transfer that amount from one account to another. And there are two users, imaginary users, Luke and Leah, and they both deposit some $5 and $10 to the bank. And now Leah wants to do a transaction of transferring $5 to Luke. So let's see how that transaction might look like, will look like in JavaScript. So first in accounts, the amount of Luke will be incremented, and then for the amount of Leah will be decreased. Now, on a single side node, just server, when the platform receives a request, then at that time it should follow the same execution trace, providing the correct response. Now, what can happen on a serverless system is that during those previous requests of depositing $5 and $10, the serverless will start a Node.js process. And it will end that Node.js process after updating it. And the memory of that Node.js process will be freed. Now, during the transaction during the request of transfer, then the Node.js process will actually start from an initial state when the amount of both Luke and Leah are zero, because the account is stored in a global variable and it's not updated here. So in this case, we should be using a persistent storage, for example, database. There is another problem that can happen due to the at least once semantics of the serverless platforms, which ensures that whenever a request is transferred to a serverless platform, then it will be executed at least once. So let's take the same transfer example. And what happened on serverless system is that it received a request. It was in the middle of performing the transfer, and unfortunately, the connection between that serverless system and the Node.js process was lost. So to maintain its at least once semantics, the serverless system started a new Node.js process. And now that new Node.js process unfortunately started from account's state when it was partially updated. So it should have instead started from an initial state. So the here the issue is that serverless function is not idempotent. Idempotency means that if a function request is applied to the function like n number of times, then it should be given the same response. What is the other problem that can happen is due to the concurrent requests. For example, during the same transfer request, another request for deposit came for layer, and now there are two parallel requests which are being executed by two parallel Node.js processes, which are modifying the same accounts variable, and so we can have a wrong response here, and we should be using transactions instead. So bank realizes all of these problems, and this was the code that earlier the bank wrote, and this is the new code after all these issues. So we can see that this new code is more than two times the previous one. So serverless programming is hard, and it has a number of challenges, which are ephemeral state, transactions, concurrency. And to provide robust tools to programmers for writing good code, a correct code, we need a deep understanding of this serverless execution model. This is where our contributions come in. We provide Lambda, which is an operational semantics of serverless platform, and it models the essential details of this serverless platform. We do three case studies, how to use Lambda. One is of naive semantics, which are an easier semantics which the programmers can use to reason about their code easily. We show that Lambda can actually compose the models of external services like key value store. And we extend Lambda to another language for composition of serverless functions. So these are the six rules of Lambda, which fit in actually one slide. And these rules describe the details of the serverless execution model. So in this Lambda, we model each platform state as a set of request and function instances. So whenever a new request comes, it will be assigned a new IDX, which will be unique. And when a request has come, after some point, the serverless system will start a new function instance to process that request. And that function instance will be started in some initial state. And after that function instance has done some processing and it has to send back the response, then it will set that function instance to an idle state. And that idle function instance can actually be reused again by the serverless platform, which will actually not start in that initial state. So this is an optimization which is done by the serverless platform to decrease the latency of the requests. And finally, the instances can die in case they are idle or in case of failures when they are busy. So this Lambda describe the details, but Lambda is too detailed, and ideally we would like to provide programmers with some higher level abstractions. So we did our first case study of to have naive semantics or serverless platform. And before we see what the naive semantics are, let's ask ourselves a question that what makes Lambda hard? So the first thing is that we are having warm state here, warm starts here, that program may not start in the initial state. So we remove that rule. And in case of failures, the program can fit anytime. So we do not have that rule either. And we also ensure that in naive semantics, there is only one request for a particular function which is being executed at one time. So with these four rules, the naive semantics are easier to reason about the serverless functions. However, the question is when the programmer can use naive semantics. The first thing to note here is that the cold start and warm start should lead to the equivalent final state. And failures and concurrent requests should not affect the final result. So let's look into this more. So imagine a request comes in, and now the program can do a cold start. That it will start from the initial state and go to the final state and then gives the response. Or it can do a warm start, and in this case, it will start from that final state and then go to another final state and give the response. So here we want that the final state and initial state should be equivalent, and steps on equivalent states should lead to equivalent states. And only in these conditions, the naive semantics can be safe to use. So if we have a theorem which says that if such an inequivalence relation exists, then we can use naive semantics. Then naive semantics are weakly bisimilar to lambda lambda, and hence we can use naive semantics to reason about a code. So let's see an example how. So this is a function that takes a username and password and does authentication, and uses a cache to decrease the number of authentication requests to database server. So once it receives the username and password, it will check whether that is in the cache. If not, then it will check in the database and update the cache. So a program state here is represented as a tuple of username, password, what are the values in cache, and what are the values in database. So when a request comes for a username password, it can do a cold start. And in case of cold start, it will start from the initial state. Hence, the username and password are not in that initial state in the cache. So it will query the database and update its cache and send by the result. In case of warm start, it will start from the final state. And if the final state already has the username and password, it will actually take fewer steps. So if we define this as an equivalence relation, that two states are equivalent if the caches of these two states are a subset of database, then we can see that the final state and the initial state are equivalent, and the steps on equivalent states actually leads to equivalent states. So in this case, the serverless function is safe because an equivalence relation exists, and for this function, we can reason about using the naive semantics. So we do our second case study, and for that we have to know that serverless functions, they are stateless. So they communicate, so the programmers write serverless function which communicates with external databases or key value storage to achieve state. And hence we extend lambda lambda with a key value store that has five rules, which are of transaction, beginning a transaction, ending a transaction. The read and writes can happen only when they are in the transaction. And a drop transaction rule, which drops a transaction and removes all the uncommitted changes. And we also extend naive semantics with the key value store. And we show that they are both weakly bisimilar to each other under some condition, for example, if the equivalence relation exists. So the programmer can reason about the code using external services even with lambda lambda. So let's move to a different case study, a practical case study in which we extended lambda lambda with a serverless composition language. So let's look what the serverless compositions are. So imagine that there are two functions which are classifiers that takes an first function takes an image and says whether it's a cat or a dog. And the other takes an animal image and says whether it's a black animal or a white animal. They are already present on the serverless platform. And a programmer wants to compose these two functions to create a new function that says whether it's an image of a black cat or a white cat. So one way that the programmer can write this composition is to write this function, which first calls the cat or dog and then calls the black or white function, and deploy it on a serverless system. Now, notice that cat or dog and black or white, these two functions are already on the serverless system. So let's look what is the timeline for it. So when the parent function is called, it will first call the cat or dog function, receives its response, and then call the black or white function. Now, notice that for the whole time, the parent function is actually alive and it's doing nothing though. It is just waiting for the response to come from the other two functions. So there was a paper at Onward 2017, which identifies this problem. And this problem is known as double billing because the programmer is being billed twice here, even though the parent function is not doing anything meaningful. So ideally, we would like to not have double billing. And one way to do that is to have the execution being interleaved between different functions. So OpenWhisk Conductor is a state-of-the-art system for writing serverless compositions. It has a state machine, which is written in JavaScript. And this state machine has execution interleaved between each of the other functions, and which decides what is the next function to be called given the particular state, in which state it is. And notice that It is written in JavaScript, hence it has to be executed inside a container. So the programmer is being built even for these OpenVSCon interaction, and we would like to decrease how much the money that is spent in this conductor action, and also improve the response time. So we extended Lambda to a serverless programming language, which provides composition primitives, which are based on Haskell arrows. So the first primitive invoke will take a function and invoke that function given some parameters. The second primitive will take two functions and invoke them by passing the output of first parameter as the input to the second function. The third is JSON transformation, which takes input in some, which is a JSON, and does some JSON transformation using a DSL, and gives back the input, and then again do some JSON transformation. So this is how the programmer will write that function in our serverless programming language. And this is how it will behave. So it will first take the input and do some JSON transformation and invoke the catalog function. Then whatever the output is, it will be combined with that first input. And then again, it will be sent to the second function using some JSON transformation, and it will get back the result. Now notice that since these JSON transformations are not truly complete, there is no need to execute them inside a Docker container. They can be executed outside them. And all of this, all of these two functions are executed in a sequence, passing the result from one function to another. So we did our first case study on how the serverless programming language behaves as compared to OpenVSCon Conductor, and on a 6-core Intel server. And we wrote several programs, both in SPL and OpenVSCon Conductor, and found that with the increasing concurrent requests, the response time of SPL is better, and the resource utilization of SPL is also better than OpenVSCon Conductor. And the reason here is that the OpenVSCon Conductor state machine is actually executing in a conductor, in a container. And in case of OpenVSCon, or in case of SPL, we do not need to execute those JSON transformations inside a container. So in conclusion, writing code for serverless platform is hard, and we present an operational semantics for serverless platform named Lambda Lambda. We present three case studies of how to use Lambda Lambda. The first is about naive semantics, which are easier semantics as compared to Lambda Lambda, and we show when are the precise conditions when the naive semantics can be used. We extend Lambda Lambda with a key value store to show that Lambda Lambda can compose models of external services also. And we extend Lambda Lambda with a function composition language to show how to compose different serverless functions efficiently. And we believe in future Lambda Lambda will actually enable development of tools that can write correct code for serverless computations. Thank you.
Any questions for the speaker?
Thanks. Did you look at applying Lambda Lambda to other composition models like AWS step functions, for example, which makes a different choice?
Since AWS step functions are proprietary, it's difficult to compare with them. So, yeah, and we are still to look into it.
Other questions? I had a question. So when you extended the language so that it had transactional primitives, what kind of transactional semantics does the language have? I guess it's a little different because it has this, these restarts that are going on. But I was wondering if it's some kind of serializability or.
Yeah, that's a good question. So there are two different transactional semantics that are happening here. In case of Lambda Lambda, we have five rules which says when to begin a transaction, when to end a transaction, when a reads are write, the reads are write can only happen inside a transaction. And here, each key value store actually has two modes of lock and unlock to say when it is in transaction. However, since the case that you described, that in case of failures, what will happen, that it has written, it has done some changes, committed it, and it has to go again in the restart. So in case of naive semantics, we have a different, we have a little different transactional model in which we have another mode of whether the changes have been committed or not. So in this case, in that case, we can handle actually the cases where the failures happen.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker once more.